Okay, thanks, Scott. I'm going to talk about some of the clinical observations that we made during this study. And we had all five patients at our site, as Scott mentioned. So I got to see all of these patients and go through the various changes that went on during the study with the patients. So I'm going to talk about safety first, because that was really the primary outcome of this very early phase study. The first safety problem that we ran into was something that was really a transient ataxia or imbalance, and sometimes fatigue or tiredness right after a dose. So this happened after 20 milligram doses and higher, was quite variable between the patients, and started about 2 to 6 hours after the infusion, and then would last slightly less than a day to even as long as 3 days with some of the 36 milligram infusions. The patients came completely back to normal when this was resolved, and they were really able to eat and interact normally during the symptom. This really looked like a central brain-derived problem that was like a cerebellar ataxia. And we've seen this with infusions of other kinds of intrathecal infusions and other diseases. So we really just watched it, and it didn't seem to be really causing any problems. So we carried on with the infusions after we saw that the patients all just resolved. There were other mild events like headaches and UTIs and typical childhood infections, but these were really unrelated to the drug or the study. And the patients all tolerated LPs and anesthesia well. So the second adverse event that we ran into was a much more serious problem. And this was the development of mild to moderate severity of weakness. And the reason it's moderate is that really only involved the legs and not the whole body. And this was seen in all five patients, and ultimately occurred 6 to 30 days after the last infusion, but may have been also related to a buildup of drug over multiple infusions. Three of the patients had really had significant weakness, and two were very, very weak, where they had trouble even really moving the legs much and were unable to walk. And in four of these patients, this occurred after the highest dose of 36 milligrams. And in one patient, it occurred after the second dose. And the patients who had the most involvement were the youngest patients. So dosing was paused for all patients after the first case was observed. And that was why you saw on Scott's picture previously that some patients didn't have all the doses that would have been projected for the study. The more severe aspects of this, where patients were not walking at all, for instance, lasted about 1 to 3 weeks, and full resolution took about 19 to 86 days. So it resolved over kind of less than a month to about 3 months. The clinical improvements that we saw in the patients, which I'm going to talk about in a minute, were sustained longer than even this serious adverse event, and actually are continuing. But vary from one patient to another. So this is just a picture of the reason for this weakness. There was an inflammation around the nerve roots that come out of out of the spinal cord. And this is just this white line here is just the abnormal inflammation that we're seeing there. And you can see the individual little nerve roots are these dots, and they're turning white, which means they're enhancing after we give contrast material, and that shows the inflammation around these nerve roots. And because the nerve roots were inflamed, they were not working correctly, and this caused the patients to develop weakness and probably some sensory changes also, although as we know in Angelman patients, it's a little bit hard to characterize those. This did not appear to be related to the post-dose ataxia problem we saw, because that really looked like a central problem and a cerebellar type of ataxia and not something related to nerve roots. And also there was no correlation in individual patients, where the patient who had the worst post-dose ataxia actually had the mildest of the nerve root problem. So these two symptoms were not really correlated and appeared to be different things. There were no other serious adverse events that required hospitalization. So we had some clinical evaluations in the study to kind of monitor how the patients were doing after they started receiving the infusions. And the interim evaluation of the clinical findings after we kind of stopped dosing people and then went ahead and did the end of study assessments, revealed that all five patients had improved in multiple domains as assessed by the CGI-I, which stands for CGI improvement, and I'm gonna explain what that is. The mean global CGI-I score went up by 2.4 points, which is really a substantial improvement because the scale is -3 to +3. All patients had at least two domains that were much or very much improved, and all patients had three domains that were minimally improved or better. So we were seeing some improvements in this study. There were other increases in the Bayley 4 expressive and receptive language communication scales and increases in the ORCA, which is the observer reported communication ability scale. Responses began after the lowest doses in some patients, and these were the younger patients. So what is the CGI? Well, the CGI was created in 1976 to be a way that we could monitor symptoms in clinical trials, kind of the way that we would in clinic. So at the beginning of the trial, we create a severity, we rate the patient on severity, where one is not impaired at all, and then 2 to 7 are increasing impairments. And so we've actually anchored these levels of impairment to the level of symptoms in different severities of Angelman syndrome. When we do this assessment, we use all the available information like a parent interview, information from school, videos, whatever we have, and the exam of the patient in front of us. We've divided this severity scale into domains of communication, sleep, behavior, gross motor, and fine motor, which are significant problem areas in Angelman syndrome. And so we use this to assess both the individual domains, and then we give the patient a global rating that kind of incorporates all of those domains as well. So this is used to determine how severe of a patient do we have in front of us at the beginning of the trial. It can be used as an outcome measure to measure change, but in developmental disorders, it's not very sensitive because you need to have a huge improvement to go up one number in this scale. And in other words, the patient could improve a lot before the scale would change. The CGI-I, on the other hand, is meant to detect change. So this is an improvement or change scale where no change is a zero. Minimally improved or minimally worse is a little change, then much improved and very much improved. So just to give you a flavor of what these kind of changes mean. So minimally improved means you kind of had a mild improvement in one area, but not an improvement that just represents, you know, kind of week to week variation that you might see in the syndrome. Much improved means this is really a good change. This is like you put somebody on an anticonvulsant and their seizures go from 10 to 2 a day, and you're thinking, I definitely need to keep this patient on this seizure medicine. Very much improved is something that you don't actually expect to happen really normally in clinic. So this is like the patient that's been on 4 anticonvulsants before and you put them on a new anticonvulsant, their seizures completely go away and you didn't actually think that could even happen. So very much improved means that's a really, you know, a significant knock your socks off type of improvement. So here is what the Clinical Global Impression Scale did during the study. And I rated all these, or Dr. Ochoa, because it's the clinician that rates this based on information from the family as well as looking at the patient. And so you can see that in some of these domains, these are the patients here, and these are the different categories over here. So in sleep, two patients got better, but actually only two patients had sleep problems. So if you don't have a sleep problem, then you can't really get better. So some of these times when there's no improvement, it just means that there wasn't a problem. In some of these behavioral areas, some of these patients didn't have a lot of behavior, so they didn't have much room to improve. Some patients had a lot more behavior, and so they had quite a bit of room to improve, and in fact showed substantial behavioral change. Everyone in Angelman syndrome has communication problems, and so we saw change in all of the patients in communication. Now, in gross motor, when we saw the patients at the end of the study, some of them were still dealing with that weakness problem from the radiculopathy involving the nerves. And so they were actually weaker, and so they actually went down in gross motor, but now all have recovered and would have a different score on this. And then fine motor improved in a few patients. This is just another graphic showing the fact that the CGI-I got better in many patients in many domains. And so each one of these clusters is a patient, and the different colors are the different domains. And as you can see, the only areas that were worse was the gross motor, and that was due to the adverse event.
Yeah.
So we also were doing the Bayley scale, and the Bayley is not always responsive to everything that happens in Angelman syndrome, but what we could see is this, for instance, is patient two, who was very severely affected with the serious adverse event. When we saw her at the end of the study, she was not quite walking yet again. So the Bayley was sensitive and it detected that she was not doing as well in gross motor. And then after we saw her later, 3 months later for another follow-up, there was an improvement in the Bayley as she recovered her gross motor ability. So this shows that the Bayley is sensitive to changes in Angelman patients. And so this just kind of gives you a schematic. We were dosing these patients, and then, you know, we were following them after their last dose, and this serious adverse event occurred kind of after they'd already had multiple, or in one case, one dose. And we still see clinical activity going on after the serious adverse event. So what did we actually see? What composed those CGI improvements? So some of the things we saw were patients acquiring spoken words, using new signs and gestures, being willing to use their augmentative or alternative communication device for the first time in a long time, ability to respond to name, follow commands, and focus on tasks, do e-learning on the computer for more than 3 seconds. Now, these were the areas where we saw improvement. And then in the motor category with fine and gross abilities, we saw one patient learned to self-feed with a fork and one improve in that regard. We saw increase in physical abilities in multiple patients. We saw one person learn to swim, to go from wearing the swimmies and just flopping around in the water to actually swimming all the way across the pool without the swimmies. And I wouldn't believe this if I didn't have videos of it on my phone. Catching and throwing a ball, improved gait and posture, ability to walk on surfaces better, go up curbs, and be more stable and more upright. So we saw quite a bit of improvement in gait. One patient had dramatically improved sleep. This is a patient who never slept through the night at all. And after he slept through the night for like 3 or 5 weeks, the family reported they didn't even know what to do with themselves because this was such a dramatic change. And then we saw improved ability to socially engage, play games, and decreased maladaptive behaviors when maladaptive behaviors were present. And then here's the Bayley scores in presented as growth scale values. What I presented before was just the raw scores. So you can see here that in terms of growth score values, some of the patients went up significantly. For instance, patient 5 in receptive communication, patient 1, patient 2 in expressive communication, and patient 1 in expressive communication. We saw an improvement in patient 1 in gross motor skills. The ones that went negative with the gross motor are patients who were still having the SAE during the event. But overall, we saw improvement in the receptive and the expressive communication area in multiple patients. And if you look over here at this plot, this basically shows what Angelman syndrome does with expressive language at this age. It's completely flat with only very minimal, very gradual improvements in receptive language. So really any improvement over a period of 4 or 5 months in these areas would be different from what typical course of Angelman syndrome would be. We had 3 patients that improved on the ORCA as well, which is the parent reported communication measure. And then this is the Actimio. These are patients wearing this device that measures how far you walk and your stride length and a lot of things. And so what we can see is that, for instance, in patient 2, we can see the Actimio going down when the patient had the adverse event, and then going up again and actually going way beyond baseline after recovery and the patient was walking around again. And so we see increases in the amount of distance the patients are walking on a daily basis across multiple outputs here. We also ran EEGs as a biomarker of drug effect, and the preliminary results here show that in a blinded independent central read of EEG by expert pediatric neurophysiologists, the readings were done. And so these people did not know which was the baseline and which was the post-drug EEG. They were reading blinded. And we were looking at things like notched delta waves, which are a common finding in Angelman syndrome, and delta power, which is broadly increased in Angelman syndrome. There's a quantitative reading of the EEG that's still pending, but the qualitative EEG shows some potential trends in that 3 of 4 had a reduction in the notched delta waves, and 3 of 4 had a reduction in epileptiform discharges either during sleep or wakefulness. So this biomarker seems to be going in the right direction as well, but there's a lot of variability, so we need more EEGs after longer treatment. Seizures were well controlled in baseline in all subjects, and no seizure adverse events were recorded. So what have we learned? Well, this was a rough trial to run because there was really kind of a mountaintop high of seeing some of these improvements going on in videos on my phone constantly. And then there was the chasm of people not walking and not being able to stand on their legs. And so it's been a little bit of a rough roller coaster ride. And I would just say that it's been probably the most kick-ass trial in both directions that I've ever run. But I think what we've learned is that this drug is clinically active even at lower doses. Higher doses cause a serious adverse event that we cannot allow to happen, and appears to be a localized effect of the drug on the lower lumbosacral spinal nerves. So the plan is to amend the protocol, start at lower doses of 3.3 and 5 milligrams, depending on the age of the individual, do individualized dose titration based on response and safety findings, and then cap the dose at 14 milligrams and avoid the 20 milligram dose. We'll be modifying the technique of the administration to try to minimize the drug at the injection site. And so the FDA has to review and approve this protocol amendment prior to resuming dosing and enrollment. So we await that, and hopefully we will be able to continue to explore the effects of this drug in a way that will promote safety. And that's it for the slides. And I would really like to acknowledge genetics, all of the people at Rush who worked intensively on the study, all of my coordinators and team, as well as Dr. Ochoa, and the patients who have thus far participated in the study and have been on this roller coaster ride with me. Okay, that's all.